Welcome to Byju's IAS, and we are very pleased to bring you yet another edition of our curated weekly review of international affairs. And this time, we are going to have a close look at the American continent, not only because one of the superpowers, perhaps the sole superpowers, occupies that geographical space, but there have also been developments in the southern hemisphere, in the southern American continent, where the emergence of Lula has posed a new challenge for the besieged president in Brazil, Bolsonaro, the country that has been grappling with COVID, and a country with which India has close ties in BRICS, and India looks forward to expanding its economic and cultural ties, political ties with the Latin American continent as well. It is very much a part of the what was considered the third world at one stage. Ever since President Biden assumed power, there has been speculation whether he would follow a soft line on China, a softer line on Russia. Would he be as confrontationist as Trump? And the Trump has been, throughout his campaign, warning American people that Biden was much too soft. He would betray America's national interest vis-a-vis China, vis-a-vis Russia. So these things have been on a watch for a short while by the international community. And in recent past, some very interesting developments have taken place in this context. So we shall begin with discussing them. The long-awaited face-to-face meeting, a summit of sorts, took place for the first time between United States of America and People's Republic of China in Alaska, in the city of Anchorage, where the Secretary of State of America met his counterpart, the Chinese foreign minister, along with a whole entourage of senior government servants, officials, diplomats, and discussed things of mutual interest. The summit started with grandstanding on part of both parts. It was decided that opening statements will be not more than 2 minutes, but the Chinese foreign minister, who was the guest, talked on and on and on and launched a tirade against America. And Americans, when their turn came, minced no words and accused China of a variety of crimes against humanity, breaking down international law norms and so on. Before the meeting started, there was speculation that what would be the stance of the American delegation. American delegation did not mince words. American delegation responded to the hyperbolic grandstanding of the Chinese foreign minister in equal measure. They also spoke beyond their time limit. And it appeared at the moment that both sides were addressing not each other, but the world at large, trying to justify their own policies. It was expected that Biden would not really be very, very soft on either China or Russia, but nobody had expected that the American delegation would come out, obviously under instruction and clearance from the White House, so hard on the Chinese side. They said that they could not deal with a country which did not believe in the norms of international law, which did not believe in a rule-bound system. And they said that the Americans were very concerned about the violation of human rights in Xinjiang of the Uyghur Muslims, the genocide which is alleged China is perpetrating against them. The American side also made it very clear that they were very concerned about the decline and demise practically of democracy in Hong Kong. And they said that the freedom of the seas, which the United Nations Convention of Laws of Seas guaranteed, was being violated by impunity. They also drew attention to the fact that the Chinese had been accused of cyber attacks at American companies, American governmental sites. And they also said that the Chinese could not be so hypocritical as to take advantage of the WTO rules, regulations and norms when it suited them, but otherwise restrict entry of other businessmen to their country. So this is quite a plateful, charges of violation of human rights, charges of not adhering to the norms of international law, not believing in a rule-based system of international politics, trying to expand in territories which were covered by the United Nations Convention on the Laws of Seas, having double standards about providing a level playing field in international trade, and of course, most dangerous, the cyber attacks on the state government sites or private industrial espionage, etc. Now, the Chinese obviously refused to accept any of these charges and allegations, and they said the Americans should not try to interfere in their internal affairs. Now, this is an extremely interesting defense, because if any country comes out with this defense that whatever it is being accused of is a matter of its internal politics and it impinges on its sovereignty, then obviously there can be no rule-based international political system, because international law presupposes that the sovereign states willfully give up a bit of their sovereign jurisdiction to have peace and harmony in international community. Now, the Chinese made it very clear that they would not accept any negotiations on these things. Now, this continued, and people thought that is what we will not compromise on. This already is a failure from the beginning. But it continued for 2 days. So there are two sets of explanations to justify this summit. One is that this was clearing the air. This was making positions not necessarily rigid, but the rock bottom, that this is what we will not compromise on. And then, of course, the negotiations can start from this point onwards. So that could be like a pressure cooker, a safety valve. You let out a lot of steam and clear the atmosphere for negotiations at various levels at this stage. That's one. The second one is that people did argue that, having said all these things, and even if there is no progress made either on Xinjiang or on Hong Kong Democratic Movement or on the laws of seas or on rule-based system immediately, there are issues where America and China must cooperate, not only to protect their individual national interest, but mutual shared national interest and the global community of nation, which has a community of nation interest. The most important thing in this is, which we shall discuss in coming days, of course, in much greater detail, is the climate change negotiations. Now, one of the first things which Biden had done was to re-enter the Paris Agreement, which had taken place in 2015, which had all but been sabotaged by Trump. Now, this is related to accepting zero emission norms for carbon emissions by a certain date and reducing the carbon emissions to an extent where at least there is no risk of the global temperature climbing up more than 2 degrees above the pre-industrial times, and different targets have been fixed for this. Now, we should not forget that two of the largest producers of carbon emissions are the United States of America and China. Now, of course, they are not comparable because the populations are quite different, and China can claim that it is trying to use fossil fuels to get back to a level to use its own natural resources to develop its economy. It has succeeded to a very large extent on that. And Americans may talk about a green politics, about emission norms which they will hit before China, but the problem is that the Americans also have a vested interest in fossil fuel economy. They control a large amount of oil and the gas in the world, and it is unimaginable that overnight this would change. So whether it is a 10-year scenario or a 20-year scenario, the climate change is one issue where America and China have to cooperate, have to accept at a compromise where it doesn't lead to a further deterioration. Some scientists already believe that we have passed the tipping point. It is much too late to make these changes. And any one side cheating on the agreement, going back on it, reneging on it, might create problems for the whole planet. Now, India is in a very interesting position. India, like China, if it is to maintain its rate of economic growth, which has suffered greatly during the COVID pandemic, will have to rely on whatever is available to it in terms of energy. Now, energy cannot be clean overnight, although the Indian Prime Minister has repeatedly tried to diversify the solar energy, the wind energy, the geothermal energy, the clean hydroelectric generation, and also other forms which are being talked about. Efficiency of the solar power is increasing. The Indian Prime Minister has been in the forefront of the Solar Alliance, Global Solar Alliance. But all these are solutions which will take time. As long as the Americans do not cut down their carbon emissions, they cannot lecture to China or India or to anybody else. Now, also there is the issue of the Americans support and protect the Gulf countries, the Saudis, which have a vital stake in oil politics and fossil fuel energy things. Now, keeping all this in mind, it is a very, very delicate operation that the Americans and the Chinese must agree on a basic minimum common program about the carbon emission, and the future of the climate change and the future of humankind, one might say, depends on this agreement. And Indians would play a very important role in persuading Americans to match their intentions with their deeds And the Chinese should be put also under a little pressure that if there is a competitive collaboration between America and China and India and China, so there is a give and take in this matter. The Chinese start with a certain advantage because they have ingratiated themselves so well into the international economic system that no country in the world can get away by totally disengaging with China, whether it is energy or any other issue. Now, what has happened recently is one more interesting development. For a long time, ever since the Cold War was over, the Russians and the Chinese were pursuing policies which were not necessarily overlapping each other's policy. The world was not clearly marked out as the socialist communist bloc and the capitalist world. There was a dialogue, there was a thaw between China and America, there was a thaw between Russia and America. This seems to be changing. What this conference at Alaska brought out was that right after that, there was a reaction and the Chinese and the Russians have come out with a statement that they have issued an appeal to the United Nations General Secretary General to call an urgent meeting of the Security Council where the five major powers, the veto-wielding powers, can discuss these things amongst themselves because no interference by any country unilaterally on issues which deal with internal politics or sovereignty are acceptable. So this is something which was not there. The other interesting part was that Biden used, while this conference was on, language which was, many would say, intemperate and undiplomatic. When he was asked in a conference, do you think that Putin is a killer? He said, yes, I do think that Putin has no soul and Putin is a killer. Now, of course, the Russian president reacted to it in equal terms and he said it needs a killer to identify another killer and let it pass like that. But the point is, he was forced to recall the Russian ambassador from America for consultations to Moscow. And also there has been these issues, the Russian diplomats being declared persona non grata by United Kingdom, sanctions being imposed jointly by Britain, America and the European Union against Russia and China. These things have also been resisted and the Russians and Chinese have said that these sanctions don't mean much. They have been reciprocated. Similar sanctions have been imposed on individuals in European Union or institutions. But these are sort of beggar thy neighbor kind of a strategy. They are in long run going to be counterproductive. But what we are watching is perhaps the beginning of another kind of a Cold War where the erstwhile socialist Marxist bloc is coming together, there China and Russia are mounting a concerted diplomatic campaign against America, trying to curb its unilateralism, and Americans are trying, whether it is through Quad or whether it is through multilateral decision making through European Union, to try to countervail the Russian-Chinese influence. Now, what complicates life in this case is this, that the Russians lie low and have let the Chinese take the aggressive stance. But what good is going to serve if Security Council calls a special meeting? Because each one of them is a veto-holding power and the stalemate in Security Council is not likely to be broken if both sides realize irreconcilable positions that China and Russia continue to claim that whether it is human rights, whether it is democracy, it is not an exportable commodity. It is not something on which there is universal agreement. And if this is a basic disagreement, then it is very difficult to imagine that the American argument either about human rights or democracy or a rule-based international system can make much progress. Now, this creates problems for India to a certain extent because our strategic interests coincide very clearly with US at the moment, not necessarily we are antagonistic with China, even if not inimical. There has been a certain coldness in our relationship with Russia in recent past. And one other interesting thing which we might as well take note of in the context of developments on the American continent, while all this was going on, the American Defense Secretary was making an official tour of India. He discussed a variety of things with India about strategic cooperation. But before leaving, the American side also made a statement that they had also discussed other issues like human rights. Now, the Indian side tried to gloss over it and said that it is not a question of disagreement about human rights in India and human rights in America, but generally because both are democratic countries, the large democratic countries, they shared exchange on of ideas on all issues. So this again is likely to be a bit of an irritant in coming years to come. At the same time, the American side, while it was negotiating with the Indian Defense Minister and the Secretary of Defense of America, they said that the Americans did not warn India about the S-400 missiles, which it is supposed to import to combat China's capabilities in Ladakh. But if they actually land here, India would find itself in a sanctionable state position. Now, whether Americans would exempt India from this, keeping the priority of holding China at bay in mind, remains to be seen. Another interesting development which took place in the southern hemisphere in America was the exoneration of ex-President Lula by the Supreme Court there. He can now theoretically, technically take part in the next year's presidential elections. Now, even if he doesn't do so, he is a rallying point for all the opposition against the authoritarian Bolsonaro, who has utterly, absolutely failed to control, take charge of the coronavirus pandemic in his country. He foo-fooed it. He dismissed it as a common flu. He himself was stricken by COVID, came back fighting, and again, he and his supporters disregard the social distancing norm, and vaccines have finally been brought to the country, but the vaccination is probably in the worst case, and it is the second largest country in the world where greatest fatalities have taken place, greatest infection has taken place, hundreds and thousands of people have died, and millions have been infected. Now, Bolsonaro has not only been in the dock for his failure for combating the coronavirus, he also has a dismal economic record. He also has been accused of corruption and nepotism. He also has been under pressure for the way he has been destroying the Amazon rainforest for personal gain or economic gain, trying to buy time. Now, he has been forced to stop this by joint pressure of many multinational corporations abroad who were vilified by all analysts and all journalists and media. So there has been some restraint on that. Now, this is not just a question of Brazil being rid of a corrupt president. Thousands of hectares of Amazon rainforest is destroyed in the name of industrialization, in the name of resettlement. It is destruction, irreversible destruction of biodiversity, and it is also destruction of a carbon sink, and it's going to create a carbon emission imprint which will nullify anything which the Paris summit was thinking about. So this Brazil situation, Bolsonaro, has been how soon the Brazilians manage to get rid of Bolsonaro and have another president, not necessarily Lula, but whoever it is, who's much less corrupt, who's much more administratively competent, who can work in an egalitarian fashion, not nepotistic, not crony capitalistic fashion, to have economic gains of economic development distributed evenly, is for the Brazilians to decide. But Indians have also had a close relationship with Brazil in BRICS, before that in IBSA, and they try to treat Brazil as the gateway to the rest of Latin America, Argentina, Chile, and so on. And Brazil has certain commonalities. They are a highly sophisticated pharmaceutical industry. They have capability of space exploration. They have nuclear energy. So it's unfortunate that the mismanagement by a political hierarchy has caused so much damage to Brazil. So this is one part. But as we were watching about what is going to happen in Brazil, another development in the Central America between the Mexican-American border is also of interest to take note of. The Biden has done a turnaround on Trump's policy. Trump was throwing back all refugees who are coming to America back into Mexico and where from they were supposed to be deported to their original countries where they are coming from. Families were separated. But right now, 17,000 teenagers and adolescents, some children, some under 12 also, are in America who have been given the right, temporary right, to stay in America and contest their status according to American laws there. And the Americans, American officials very pompously pronounce that we are not that kind of a nation. We have a very humanitarian view of these things. But the fact remains that to begin with, there are no facilities thanks to the short-sightedness of Trump. No provision has been made for these underage refugees to come and live under humane conditions on the American side of the border. Many are separated from their parents. You also have to segregate them them according to gender, according to age, and you have to keep them under conditions which are not inhuman. So there are this case, and also using the pandemic excuse, the immigration policies had been turned topsy-turvy by the Trump regime. He had also threatened to build a wall. Thank God that has not happened. But Mexicans are also not in a position, if only the children who have managed to get inside America or the parents who have got inside, they cannot, these separated families cannot be maintained by Mexico under any circumstances. The Americans still have some resources, but Mexicans have none. And this again is an issue which is fraught with many complications. There are smugglers under the guise of refugees. There is traffic of narcotics and other activities, smugglers. And you have to watch very carefully whenever these refugee issues are there. Many of them, the refugees who ultimately want to enter into America, have no right. They only have a right of asylum into Mexico. But Mexico can't cope with it. So this is a shared problem. And this is again going to test the intentions and capability of Biden's administration to cope with this threat towards the southern border. It is time to turn our attention from the American continent to Asia nearer home. And the incident which is being looked after with great concern and interest is Indian Prime Minister's visit to Bangladesh. Bangladesh is celebrating the 50th anniversary of its independence this year, and the Indian's contribution towards its struggle for independence was significant. It's remembered gratefully by Bangladeshis, and the Indian Prime Minister is making an exception of doing a physical visit much rather than doing any virtual congratulations and exchange of greetings to the Bangladeshi leadership. Now, the interesting part is this, that the moment this visit was announced, there were certain protests against the visit of Indian Prime Minister to Bangladesh. The protests were large enough to cause concern, and the Bangladeshi Ministry of Home and Foreign Affairs had to issue assurances that absolutely there is no security threat, and there are a few miscreants who are raising these slogans. In a democratic society, it is possible, but there should be no concern about Indian Prime Minister's visit to Bangladesh. The Indian Prime Minister has made some goodwill gestures even before that, inaugurating a bridge in Northeast, which will cut short the travel time between the Northeastern states and the cities in Bangladesh. But the problem is the basic irritants continue. And these irritants are the amendments in the citizenship law in India and also the National Population Register. Now, in both cases, the statements which were made by the Indian side have caused concern in Bangladesh. Because A, the illegal immigrants from Bangladesh were referred to in a very derogatory manner. It was said that they would be pushed back, they were like locusts, they would not, termites, they would not be tolerated, and they would be destroyed, they would be pushed back, etc. Now, this obviously hurt the nationalist sentiment in Bangladesh. Now, the other concern is that the Indians do not seem to be sensitive enough to the threat of anti-Indian elements active in Bangladesh. Sheikh Hasina has been trying to have a closure of the tragic events of 1975 when her father and the family were slaughtered and murdered. And anybody found guilty of that conspiracy has been brought to book and is executed. But some of these people who have been executed have been apprehended, who were living under different aliases in India. And there is a small but powerful lobby which is tied to Begum Khalida, Khalida Zia, and there are elements of ISI from Pakistan which keep fostering an anti-India sentiment there. Unfortunately, there has been some spread of the fanatical, dogmatic, terroristic virus even in the affluent sections of the Bangladesh society, as it was obvious in a few months back, when in a posh colony there were bomb blasts and so on. So the problem is that the Indians have to see that there is a balance between a friendly regime in Bangladesh. Is it not worth its while to make certain concessions? Not that India has to concede or appease, But there are legitimate expectations of the Bangladeshi government that if we are so friendly to the government in India, shouldn't it have a more flexible, more resilient attitude towards water sharing, about exchange of enclaves? Of course, it was very satisfactorily done. Unfortunately, here again is election time in West Bengal. And in West Bengal, at one stage, the Chief Minister Mamata Banerjee was a great votary of unified Bengali cultural, political identity, shared economic resources. But when it comes to the crunch, and when it is a government which is confronting her in the center, she is not willing to cooperate very easily. She had refused to do so for Manmohan Singh before in the past, Prime Minister Manmohan Singh. And it is not likely that in the year of election, she is going to make any statements which would strengthen the hands of the BJP government in center. And she would very strongly say that I am resisting and protecting the interests of the citizens of West Bengal before I am making any concession to the Bangladeshis. Now the problem, both, and Assam is again a state which is going for an election at the moment. Now the problem is that these states, Assam and Bengal, because of CAA, because of the registration of National Register of Citizens in India, and the election, the outsider-insider issue becomes very important. Now, the BJP at one level, at the electoral level, is going to argue that it is the appeasement of the, or the protection given to illegal immigrants from Bangladesh and the Muslims, which is trying to change the demography in Bengal and voting pattern in Assam. At the same time, you can't go to Bangladesh and say that, look, we are ultimately people whose interests coincide almost totally. We have 4,000 kilometer long border. We have to live together and live happily. Now, unless this is done, unless some concrete progress is made in Indo-Bangladesh relations after this visit, it will only leave a residue of frustrations and hopes belied, and it would allow a country like China to come out with offers of economic assistance, technical assistance, some true, some mirages, but it will be not, certainly not to Indian interests. So the Indian Prime Minister's visit is going to be watched with interest and some concern. Perhaps some of the most tragic developments in international relations take place in what has been called the dark continent, the continent of Africa. And particularly, the northwestern tip of Africa has been plagued by endemic violence, which doesn't seem to be stopping or ebbing at all. Between the month of January and March, more than 1,000 lives have been lost, innocent civilians, some soldiers, some policemen patrolling, and kids have been kidnapped from schools, some freed, some butchered, some have been traumatized, girls have been raped, villages have been razed in arson. And in Niger, one of the poorest countries in the world, the most recent event was when motorcycle riders wielding guns killed 135 plus civilians. Just before that, a couple of days before that, the similar kind of motorcycle riders had targeted a bus and killing 40 to 50 civilians. Just before that, another two, within a week, these incidents took place. They had targeted the soldiers and killed them traveling in their bus from one point to another point. Now, what happens is, at the first glance, it appears that all these crimes, these terroristic activities, have been perpetrated by ISIL, which keeps changing names. In Nigeria, it is Burkina Faso. In Niger, it becomes some fragment of ISIL, a fragment of Al-Qaeda, Al-Shabaab somewhere else. And it is easy to conclude that only fundamentalist Islam is responsible for this. If you look deeper, remove a layer, it becomes obvious that had Islam not been there, there would still have been endemic inter-tribal violence in this area. Is extreme poverty, the governments at times fail to pay their army their wages, the policemen are reluctant to risk their lives under these circumstances, population runs away from villages which have been attacked by these bandits, they take shelter in bush, and you can't provide shelter to these people in bush. Half a million people have been rendered refugees within Niger in the past few months, 6 months or so, and there is a spillover of this violence like lava from a volcano from one country to another country. These terrorists take shelter after perpetrating a crime, say in Niger, in Mali, in Chad, in Burkina Faso, in Nigeria, or at sometimes from Nigeria the other way around. Now, the only force which has been trying to have some kind of a semblance of order was the deployment of French soldiers here. Now, President Macron has been under pressure to withdraw his soldiers from this place. The French people do not want French lives to be lost in a cause where they don't think that enough French national interest is directly involved. But the point is that the French are not doing this for a humanitarian purpose only. It is an area where French have been traditionally influential, and especially in the Sahel countries, south of Sahara, the France wants to retain a presence for two reasons. A, it wants to project to the world without that it is a major power within Europe and which has capabilities to project its power elsewhere. It can play an international role, and also it is also guarding the resources in an area where anarchy prevails, so that the multinational corporations, not necessarily French, but some French, has been traditionally an area of influence, can continue to exploit the mineral resources in this country and benefit economically. Now, if the French withdraw, it is very difficult to imagine how long can countries like Niger not fall into a dark abyss of anarchy and violence. Now, there is little which the rest of the world can do about it. You can have sanctions, you can take a particular leader and put him before the International Court of Criminal Justice, take him to a tribunal, hold him guilty of human rights violations, but it will not change the ground reality anywhere, whether it is Burkina Faso, whether it is Niger, whether it is Nigeria, Mali, Chad, you know, or the Congo, Democratic Republic of Congo, or almost bordering up to Uganda. There doesn't seem to be an easy solution here at all. The countries are comfortable dealing with the Maghreb in the north. The moment you come down to Northwest Africa, the moment you come to Central Africa, the rest of the world seems to lose interest entirely. This is all we have for you this week. We look forward to meeting you again next week with another edition of the Weekly Review of International Affairs. And by that time, we are sure that some of these developments which we have discussed today would have either turned for better, or maybe if they are trying to get a little more complicated, we would also analyze for you how the rest of the international community is going to cope with it. There are other interesting developments taking place all over, which we look forward to sharing with you. The Yemeni civil war and the Saudi relationship. The Saudis have offered a ceasefire to Yemenis. Yemenis have rejected it out of hand. They say that Saudis first should remove the blockade on the ports and airports so the humanitarian crisis can be dealt with. Then they would be willing to talk. And somewhere in the background is Iran, which supports the Houthis in Yemen. But then again, to balance Iran, the Saudis and the Gulf countries have been trying to cultivate Israel. But Israel itself is in a bit of a political turbulence and having the fourth elections within a year. So I think we are in for a very interesting developments in the Middle East, and also interesting developments elsewhere. We shall cover them when we meet the next. Till then, goodbye.